welcome to Mindscapes, a series of conversations with men and women whose ideas, vision, and philosophy define our contemporary world. My guest today is one of India's preeminent heart surgeons. He pioneered open-heart surgery in India and has been responsible for creating systems and structures to bring and make available to the community in India heart care to the best international standards. I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Naresh Trehan.
Thank you.
You're a heart surgeon, and in a way we're familiar with the images of the physiological heart, but you also have the other kind of heart, the good heart. What is the relationship between the two?
Good heart and the actually biological beating heart. No, we have a belief that the soul actually resides somewhere in the transverse sinus, which is just a little above the pumping chambers. Why we say that is because we find that most people, and it doesn't apply to everybody, but most people who have undergone the harrowing experience of having to undergo heart surgery at some point or the other, and then recovered from it and restored to full health, something happens to their behavior pattern. And like I said, unfortunately it's not 100%, but greater than 90% of the people actually change, see life differently, in a positive way, I say that. So we say, maybe we have fiddled with the heart, that murmur of the heart, as you call it, when we are tampering in there. But there is some relationship, of course. It's more ethereal. You can't actually describe it.
In what ways, to sort of take that analogy a little further, in what ways does the kind of person you are, and perhaps we could take this beyond the sort of the familiar type A personality and people who are more prone to this, have to do with the condition of your heart?
You know, unfortunately, this is a multifactorial problem. People who develop coronary artery disease, which is the acquired form of heart disease. And there are many attempts have been made, and we have actually subsets, like you mentioned, type A personality, which actually translates into hyperactive, stressed out individuals in simple terms. But in addition to that, you will find people who have no visible risk factors, they still get coronary artery disease. As we also know, biologically, there are genetically, some people are prone to it. Diet-wise, people are prone to it. Lack of exercise, they're prone to it. So if you look at it in what subsets you see it, well, you'll definitely see it in the subset of people who have maybe genetic risk factors, have a high cholesterol, sedentary lifestyle, and then on top of that, to have a type A personality. So that's a recipe for disaster. So we actually, you know, we study these different aspects of an individual and then try to manipulate or we say modify the lifestyle into a more intelligent survival lifestyle.
You know, how do you respond to sort of, you know, Dean Cornish is represents a sort of an approach which says that, look, if you can change your lifestyle, you can reverse heart disease, you can maybe unclog your arteries. To what degree do you subscribe to that possibility?
One little correction, it's Dean Ornish, O-R. I do subscribe to that whole methodology, although Dean Ornish, I think, has a point. To make that point, has carried it to a level where for most individuals, healthy individuals who want to live life, it becomes kind of difficult to follow that extreme a program. But what you're basically saying is that if you are aware of the fact that you have coronary artery disease, and that is the lacuna which existed and we are trying to break that right now, is that maybe you can reverse it by X number of changes in your biochemistry and your lifestyle. Okay, that's very possible. But the key to it is that you must detect coronary artery disease when it is in the early stages. That means when the blockages are 30, 40, max 50%. And these programs are effective. Why they are effective? Yes, because supposing we find somebody's got high cholesterol, there are now drugs known as simvastatins and stuff, or statins we call them, and they actually reduce the cholesterol, and they're known to, some of them are known to absorb the fat back into the system. So So the body has that capability. But the risk is that if you detect coronary artery disease when it's advanced to 70%, 80%, 90%, that while you are trying to do all this, you may get there's a 50% chance that you may get a heart attack. So this Dean Ornish program, as we may all put it as an umbrella, or lifestyle modification program, is not very successful in those individuals, because you are running a very high risk of suffering major injury to your heart muscle or dying from it. So what our effort today is, and this is one of the things that we have done right now at our Heart Institute, at Scott's Heart Institute, is to establish the early coronary artery detection center. And we have combined the power of two very sophisticated machines available now. One is the rapid sequence spiral CT, which does calcium scoring. And calcium scoring means that we can look at, with this device, look at the presence of calcium or deposits of calcium in the arteries or the coronary arteries in an individual. And we have now, after our research, come up with what we call the calcium burden index. Now, if you have X amount of calcium burden in your arteries, we know that the chances of developing coronary artery disease further are quite high. And if you get that early warning, then you can actually modify your lifestyle. And same thing with the cardiac MRI, where we actually visualize the blood flowing through coronary arteries and we can see if there are blockages appearing. So the idea being that so far this was missing.
With the growing commercialization of medicine, and there have been press reports of how commercially driven hospitals have maybe compromised on healthcare or tend to be exploitive of people, you run an institute that is a research center that makes commercial good sense but isn't entirely profit driven. How do you strike the balance between making your own ends meet the institution? It involves capital investment, there are running costs, you need certain degree levels of occupancy, you need certain number of surgeries a day or a year. How does an institution balance those two sort of parameters?
I'll just give you a little quote first of mine, which I say is that good medicine makes good business, but good business does not make good medicine. And I think people who have gotten it reverse are the ones who have actually brought the bad name to our profession. You know, if you take a person who's sick, okay, he wants to get well. He wants to get well desperately and at a cost so that he doesn't have to sell his home and wife to get well. But if you indulge in unnecessary operations, or you have this panic in you that you've made an investment and you need to recover it, so you know you give commissions to people to send you patients, and this is, mind you, happening because people have put this pressure on themselves, in because you don't have to become an entrepreneur. Now there is actually commercialization of the whole society. I mean, the value systems have actually, you know, have gone through the floor basically, and doctors are not isolated. Especially people who, you know, who want to get into that fact of, you know, that I need to make a success. And success in the traditional medical sense, success does not mean how much money you make, is how many people you can fix and how much gratification you get from society. At the same time, making enough money to have a decent life. I'm not Mahatma Gandhi. I do not say that you should not have enough money to educate your children or meet your life's obligations, because that's also sad, that you get carried away with yourself so much then your whole family falls apart or is shortchanged. I think that's not right either. So given that you have a reasonably good lifestyle, your actual strength, your satisfaction comes from how well you practice medicine and what people think of you. Because if you have a satisfied patient, he will bring you at least 10 patients in his lifetime. I used to believe this many years ago, but it's more than tested.
One of your achievements really has been to institutionalize, create systems and structures that reflect, manifest, the philosophy that you're coming from in that sense. How have you been able to reconcile your professional training as a surgeon to what is essentially a management function?
Good. I've got very strong views about this, okay, because I've come full circle. Okay, I think first of all, what comes through no matter what you're running and what you are doing is that if the person who's running a place is competent, he will definitely get respect because you are actually contributing or adding value to whatever you're doing, to every individual you come into contact with. So if you are at that level and you make sure you stay at that level, the important thing is to be more aware, more educated, more, you know, tuned in and hardworking, then people will definitely respect you. You don't need any great mantras of management. I have one theory because, you know, we as Scott's Heart Institute became a success, quote unquote, and then people will say, okay, you know, lots of people come saying, make one for me and do this and do that. And for 10 years, I resisted that because this was an artificial system or we had established in the middle of, you know, people still go home and they live in, you know, what kind of environment, and they come to work and they come in a different environment. So till the systems were in place, and I could only explain it in what I call the mushroom theory. The mushroom theory goes like this. The stronger the stem of the mushroom, the larger the umbrella you can support. So if you're in a rush and you try to take on too much, I think you will, there are greater chances of failing than success. So we have internally, you know, actually strengthened our systems and also did not hesitate to teach. See, you talk about how to, I think doctors are, rightfully so, a difficult set of people because intellectually they are advanced, they know their knowledge has value. So if you provide a fair system, and I think governance is basically fairness, if you are transparent and you are fair, that's the best you can hope to be. So if you can provide a platform for the doctors to be able to perform their work, not only able to perform but to enhance their work, and they feel the sense of encouragement and everything is transparent, then I think it has a chance of greater success as a system, as an institution. And also without fear to teach the younger people. You don't let them come up because they will be your asset one day. It's very difficult to understand that because in immediate terms there is this thing of, you know, they'll come to bite your hand one day and all that. And I threw all these cautions to wind long ago.
Are you ever, I'm sure you are. So how do you handle the anguish that heart care, heart surgery is as expensive as it is, and it really is accessible to only a very small minority in the community? How do you handle this anguish for yourself?
See, if you look at it, all modern form of treatment where diagnostics and therapeutics have very expensive inputs. You take a MRI scan to diagnose brain tumor or heart problems or CAT scanner. These things cost crores and crores of rupees. I'll give you an example. We do heart surgery at 1/10 the cost of what it costs in America. Our results are, if anything, better than people in America, and I say that with conviction because we have tested it in many international fora. In spite of the fact that we have been able to reduce it by 1/10, it is still far out of reach of 99% of the Indians, okay? Because that 1.5 lakh figure, or between 1.5 and 2 lakhs, is still out of reach. Now, if you translate it back into US, that $40,000 is also out of reach of 99% of the Americans. They know, they're not, 99% of Americans cannot write a check for $40,000. It's only insurance that makes it possible for the Americans to access healthcare. We, unfortunately, in India, did not have any healthcare insurance to speak of. Now, in the government's wisdom, it took many years, but it's happened finally, that we expect that healthcare products will come on market where you can, with a reasonable sum of money, say 2,000-3,000 rupees a year, buy adequate protection for yourself and your family. Now, 2,000-3,000 is within the ambit of many, many people. They can afford it. But writing a check for 1.5-2 lakhs, you can't. I'll give you the example of an echo machine. An echo machine with which we diagnose heart problems can cost anywhere from 30 to 50 lakhs of rupees. A very good one will cost 80 lakhs of rupees fully loaded. Now, that translates into $200,000 or $150,000 in the US. They charge $1,000 or $800 per test. So all it takes is 200-300 tests to cover the cost of a machine. We charge 1,000 rupees. So 1,000 rupees to cover 80 lakhs will mean you need to do 8,000 echoes to just cover the cost of the machine, and it'll take you a few years to do it. So the cost of money will keep going. So there is a mismatch there, that we have to import all these equipments at very high cost. Today, with the dollar, the way the dollar is going and the rupee diving, it's only going to make it more difficult. So it's not anybody's fault, although because we are the providers, one thinks, oh, the doctor is expensive. It's not so. The doctors are not making huge, huge sums of money. It is basically the inputs are so expensive, and as rightfully, we should get the best care in the world.
But as consumers, aren't we, in a sense, victims or subject to the doctor or the hospital's need to do those 8,000 echocardiograms as soon as possible? And do you think there can be legislative control, or is it just the larger moral imperative that you're talking about?
I like that question because I'd like to address it. See, today what has happened is that there is a free marketplace for medicine. Okay. So you may find one square mile has three MRIs. It doesn't make any sense at all. Even in the country like US, because you can benchmark it against that, there is such a thing as known as certificate of need. Before a hospital is allowed to buy a piece of equipment, which is manufactured in their own country, you must establish, and this is for larger equipments, okay? To establish a certificate of need, to say, yes, in that area, you need something like this. There are three angiography labs in one area, what's going to happen? Then somehow for survival, those people are going to try to extract patients. They're going to do unnecessary procedures. They may even give, or possibly do give already, commissions to physicians. Now that is where a patient is being victimized. And I think there is nothing worse than that. If a doctor is caught giving commissions, he should be debarred. So there may be some overall kind of guideline put out, which can at least be challenged. Okay, to say enough. There are enough hospitals here, there are enough. So if somebody needs to put another hospital, if somebody needs to expand their facility, they should be able to show, yes, the patients need it. And legitimate patients need it. It's not because I will first build and then I'll get the patients. Okay. So I'll give you an example. Umpteen number of people ask me, please build us we are willing to go 500 crores, build us a flagship in Bombay, you can do it, and with your name. Listen, Bombay doesn't need another hospital, as far as I know. Why don't you build one in Bihar or UP or Rajasthan, where it is needed? We don't have to spend 500 crores. Let's create models, and that's what we have done now. We are now going to take, I'm now working on the rural healthcare model, private initiative, where I want to do that hub and spoke of take up a state, capital one, and emergency medicine and heart is our forte. I don't want to indulge in anything. Let the other people who are very good at other things, let them also join in or do it on their own. But do it where it's needed, not where you think you want to make money. Mm-hmm. I think that those are the things.
You know, one of the sort of qualities about you that sort of evoke affection, admiration, and respect in the community is not just your sort of passionate commitment as a surgeon, as managing a hospital, but also your sense of the sort of the fullness of life. As you said, that you're not a Gandhi, and you enjoy living life to the full. What is this philosophy of life that circumscribes your work?
You know, I'll give you one related back to medicine. And it'll go back to your question. Don't you feel this angst about poor people and stuff like that? So, as part of my own ethos, and fortunately, my associates in this whole project are also of the same bent of mind. So we started a huge community outreach program. The community outreach program is a mobile program where we have, we'd hold camps, including we created the first bus, the echocardiography bus, where we can take echocardiography machine on a platform which is air cushion suspension, because these machines go out of kelter very quickly. And we have been to places like Chapra in Bihar. So on an this year our target is to examine 1 lakh poor people in their environment, rather than expecting them to come to us because they can't even probably afford to come here. And the angst comes out of those people who you diagnose, and then if you have to tell them how to get treatment. So we have, as my own, a huge effort to raise money. We contribute free from the hospital, and then whatever is needed to be bought, we will try to raise money from friends, organizations and things like that, to actually be able to help them beyond what just diagnosis. So that is one aspect outside of my daily work which gives me great satisfaction. The other thing, I am a true believer that if you are a one-track person, then your ability to actually deal with life becomes that limited, because your ability to expand your vision and other people's visions with you is limited. So I like to, as a principle, I don't like to, after I finish 12 hours of work, which is the normal routine, then I don't like to, discuss medicine in social environments. So as you can see, I hesitate, but I socialize less and less with doctors, because then, work comes up and all that. So where else, if you are exposed to other people, other disciplines, other ideas, it actually incorporates in your mind and you apply it. A lot of IT, stuff, movies, and you must relax, unwind yourself, otherwise you go nuts.
Mm-hmm. You meditate?
I do yoga and I meditate. Mm-hmm. So both the things, exercise when I can 3-4 times a week, and also I socialize. So because I think that it's essential to actually unscrew your brain every so often, as long as you don't overdo it, And I think one of the biggest problems people have who work or can have is excessive drinking. Now, drinking is I think a major problem, and because I don't know why it doesn't make you feel that good, but it makes you feel lousy, of course, afterwards. And that's the difference between the old economy and the new economy, and people who could drink late, eat late, come to work at 11 o'clock, the factories were working, no matter how much inefficiency there was, you still minted money and you could have a royal lifestyle. So thank God those days are gone. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, it's sweat, mm-hmm. equity.
And do you believe that sort of that 1 ounce or 2 ounce of red wine really makes the difference?
We know, I think it does, because there are some studies, but we know that red wine is very rich in tocopherol. Tocopherol, the grape skin is vitamin E. So that has to be, that's the natural form of vitamin E, so you're taking it and enjoying it. And I think it relaxes you. Like we are saying, if that much amount of alcohol is okay, we say it only to say that it breaks the cycle.
Do you feel comfortable? Do you drink that much alcohol yourself?
No, I will have one glass of wine, mm-hmm. or one small drink, that's it. Mm-hmm. Because I have to keep my faculties intact. I'm saved from myself by my profession, so which is great. Uh-huh. And I don't like it anyway. I've uh-huh. always been this way. No,
I meant, do you sort of see that as medicinal and therapeutic?
I enjoy a glass of wine, yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. I think it does relax you, although, meditation, yoga and all does the same thing. Mm-hmm. But it also makes for, a break in, you can't be an ascetic. I mean, people who are, I'll tell you, people who overdo it, mm-hmm. get obsessed with themselves, are greater victims of mm-hmm. illness than people who can have a moderate, relaxed lifestyle. You do your work, you do what you know best, mm-hmm. enjoy yourself, mm-hmm. and actually negative thought process is one of the major problems. I was talking about mm-hmm. conflict, I didn't elaborate mm-hmm. on it. But, how do you get into a state where father, son, brothers, sisters are having a conflict? And I can't imagine anybody being able to rest in peace or sleep well or enjoy life mm-hmm. if you have those kind of conflicts going on in life. Mm-hmm. So one has to have a larger view, mm-hmm. even if there are conflicts, to try to mm-hmm. actually overcome them.
So do you feel that you're able to sleep well and have through your practices, your lifestyle, the work that you do, and sort of the interwoven satisfactions? Do you think, you feel you've achieved that lifestyle yourself?
Yeah, but, you know, I personally, mm-hmm. I think a lot of peace with myself. I sleep well, no problem. Mm-hmm. I have, but one of the things that I'll admit to is that having worked the way I have worked, mm-hmm. which is, you know, for 7 years in my training period in New York, mm-hmm. I slept maybe 2 hours a night. Mm-hmm. We were always revved up mm-hmm. on adrenaline energy. It was basically mm-hmm. that kind of high-strung state. Mm-hmm. And in retrospect, if you ask me, yes, I would have maybe mm-hmm. tried to spend more time with the family and be less mm-hmm. ambitious about learning. But to find that balance, you know, at that time, if you want to reach where you want to reach because you want to be the best, that kind of thing, in the American environment, it takes that. And that I have deliberately tried to avoid at Escorts Heart Institute. Mm-hmm. For my own people, for my own trainees, from my own, I don't want them to go. I want them to go through that 90% experience, mm-hmm. but that last 10% leave for their families.
Well, thank you very much. That's
okay,
been great.
I enjoyed that. Thank you very much.